The following is an interview with Mrs. Felicia Shloss at her home in Oak Park, Michigan, on the evening of March 4th, 1982. The interviewer is Professor Sidney Bolkowski. Could you tell me your name, please?
My name is Felicia Shloss. It's English. I was born Teich. My maiden name was Teich, Felicia Teich.
And where were you born?
In Piotrkow. It's about, I think, 40 miles from Łódź. And we moved to Łódź when I was maybe 10 or 11 years old. We lived there. My father was a worker. He was working in a newspaper. We weren't rich, but we went to school. We had all the necessities of life. We didn't have any car. We didn't have any luxury as people have here, but we had schooling, food, clothing, and we had family. We weren't deprived of anything, as I remember. I was never hungry before the war.
How large was your family?
I had two brothers and a sister and I.
And grandparents too?
I remember grandmother. When I was a child, my grandfather died, so I don't remember him too well.
Aunts and uncles?
Yes, I had... my father had four sisters, and they all were married, they had children. And he had one brother, he went to South America, which I saw him in 1974, he came here.
He went before the war?
Yes, he went by the beginning in the 30s, like 31 or 1930, I don't remember exactly what year. And they were all killed during the Second World War.
All four sisters?
No, my father's all sisters were killed.
And your immediate family?
My two brothers. One died because we didn't have enough food in the ghetto. He was growing and I didn't have my parents anymore. They took... we lived in the city, and then when they made the ghetto, they made... my mother, she rented a room someplace in the ghetto. And a night before, she gave us some things to take there. We had already a place to be in the ghetto. And she was waiting for the Germans to, the next day, to have, I don't know what they would have, either a truck or a horse and buggy to take the belongings. And we went back, that was in March in 1940. And they just cut off the streets, and we never saw our parents again.
How old were you?
I was 59 in November.
So you were a child?
Yeah, I was 16, 17.
Were there cousins?
Yeah.
First and second cousins in the same...
My mother had only one sister, and she... Maybe somebody's alive. She emigrated to Paris, France. But I was so young, I don't remember her address because I didn't write to my aunt. My parents did. But...
Did all your family live close by? Were they all...
Yes, yeah. Yeah, there were half in Łódź and the other half was in that other place.
So what was your household like? What was a Friday night like?
Oh, we had a Shabbos dinner. We always, my mother used to bench bless candles. We had a full Shabbos dinner. All the holidays were in the Orthodox way. And we had a Seder. We had all the holidays. We used to go to grandmother for the holidays. We used to go to our aunts for the holidays.
So did you belong to a shul?
My parents, sure. I was a young girl. I used to go to Bat Yankov at that time. And they used to learn Jewish and Hebrew. And
It's a cheder, basically, like a cheder.
Yeah, but all are girls cheder, yeah.
Do you know about how large the Jewish community was in Łódź?
How large? I think it was 170,000.
Now, of course, you didn't know everybody, so.
No, but I remember I was working in the ghetto. They used to say that 170,000 Jews were in Łódź, yeah.
And in your neighborhood, were there mostly Jews where you lived?
Yes, we did live in a Jewish neighborhood.
Were there any, did you go to a Jewish school, or was it a Polish school?
Yeah, I went to a Polish school maybe for 3 years, a Catholic school. It was a public school, but most of the kids were Polish children, Catholic. Mm. We all were Polish because you were a citizen of Poland.
So you'd go to school during the day, and then to cheder when?
Like here, we used to go after school, like 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, for an hour or so. We used to go to Bat Yaakov, Jacob's, the daughters of Jacob's, I believe, was the name.
Were you assimilated? Did you think that you were assimilated?
Not really. My father was a Jew. My grandfather used to, like my father was in the newspaper, my grandfather used to make the Jewish books. How do you say, Chumash? The Torah?
Yeah.
He used to put the books, the Jewish books. They knew that they were Jewish. We weren't so much assimilated.
Did you have non-Jewish friends?
Yes, I had some friends, but they weren't really your friends. They were acquaintances, like.
Would they come to your house?
Yes, they came to my house. They came to my parents' house. I remember they used to like very much the gefilte fish. My mother used to. They were invited to dinner, and they liked very much the gefilte fish.
Did they invite you back?
No, we wouldn't go to eat there because it wasn't kosher.
But did you ever go to their house?
Yes.
So it was a good, reasonable
friendly relationship? I don't know. It was superficial, like. It wasn't friendly. You did because you had to do it.
Do you remember any anti-Semitism?
Oh, yeah. They used to call you dirty Jew. They used to call you that you killed Jesus. They used to call you names, sure.
Anyone in your family ever experience worse incidents?
Should I tell about? At that time, it's a long time ago, it's probably 45 or more. It's probably 50 years ago. They were building sewers, like we call it kanalizacja. It was sewers, yeah? Water pipes or some pipes. So what they were digging, that was in Piotrkow. They were digging, and I went from school, and my younger brother, and a boy pushed us down in those holes. And he threw stones and dirt on us. So the boys, some kids saw what he was doing. He was older than us, that boy who did it. He could have been 13 because I was younger. My brother was 7. I was probably 9. So instead of going to my mother telling what's going on, I went to my older brother. My older brother was like a hero, like he was very smart and very. So what did he do? He took off his shoe, or he punched him in the nose, on the face or something. He gave him a bloody nose. And that son was, the father was managing the post office or something. I don't know exactly at that time. I was young. And they came to my father, or some Jewish people came and told my father to give them $300 or whatever the money was. And my father said, no, two boys had a fight and that's it, and I'm not going to. So he took my brother to court, and he showed that he is He fought for Poland. He had a cross, virtue military.
Your brother did?
No, that Paul, not the boy, the father of the boy. And I remember even before the war, my father used to tell all the time the story. Well, my brother was very good in school. They didn't do anything to him. And my father, I guess, was smart. He took a lawyer and they made it like two boys had a fight. They didn't tell them that the boy before pushed us down in that
sewers.
And probably it wasn't too high because we wouldn't get out. It was for the water pipes, I believe. That was the incident that marked in my head that I remember that well.
Did anyone in your family have political affiliations? Did they belong to any political groups?
No.
Zionists?
Yeah, my father, all Jewish people were Zionists. Our whole dream was Israel. But he belonged to a shul. I don't remember him belonging to any other organization.
Do you remember them ever talking about politics in your house? About politics?
They were talking about the war, and when the war started, it was a terrible thing, and what Hitler will do with us, and all those things.
But nothing before?
No. The Jews, they talked a lot about Israel, and my uncle, the one who, he died a year ago, 2 years ago, he was in the Maccabi, it's a Jewish organization, and he went by a bike. At that time they had special bikes, thick things like a motorcycle, but it wasn't a motorcycle, it was a bike. Like, he went to Israel by bike. Yeah, it was not only him, but there were a whole bunch of young men who went to Israel.
And he stayed there?
No, he came back. Obviously, he came back because he. Then I remember this. Maybe I was 5 or 6 years old when he went to Israel by bike.
Would you have gone? Were people thinking about going to Israel?
Oh yes, there was a dream. When I was a little girl, every time I had a penny or something, there was Keren Kayemet. It's like here the national fund. We all put a penny, and anything we had, we put for Israel.
Let me just ask a couple more things about before the war. What kind of cultural life? Were there concerts,
theater? Oh, yes,
theater?
Concert, theaters, shows, and we used to go to Yiddish Jewish theater, and we used to go to the library, to the museum, and to... My father loved very much horse racing, and we didn't have it the whole year. We just had it in the fall, you know, they couldn't afford to keep this. And what else? The paper was every day, a new paper in our house. I used to buy myself magazines then when we grew a little bit, my brother and I. And all the theaters, all the shows, all the musical. I saw the movie May Day in Poland. I was at that time 16, with Jeanette MacDonald and Nelson Eddy. This I remember, I saw it.
Now, were these Jewish theaters or Jewish movie houses?
No, not particularly. This was a regular movie house.
Yeah. Was there a Yiddish theater too?
Yes, every city had a Jewish.
Do you remember any of the names of the people?
The famous Jewish... Who were the famous women? Jigan, Schumacher.
Schumacher.
Who else was famous woman? Who was famous? He was...
Molly Picon.
You remember her in Lodge?
Yeah.
I don't remember her exactly. What did I see? Something Jewish. My mother used to be more the theater. We were too little to go. But then later, when I grew up, we saw movies. Carmen. I saw Carmen. I heard we had like in Paris, they had the outdoor cafes, little restaurants and outdoor in the summertime. And they used to come singers there. I heard Granada, you know, all the Italian music and the Spanish were very popular, very famous on the radio. And we had the radio, yeah. No television at that time, just the radio.
When the war began, do you remember where you were when you first heard about it?
We were digging. We supposed to hide and how do you call it, Romek? How do you call that?
Resistance.
A copper, like I was digging and I hurt myself. I remember I heard the siren and people were crying. Elderly women were crying and we thought it was fun. Being 16 years old.
You were digging trenches?
Yes, yeah. Some digging.
Who told you to dig the trenches?
The Polish, they told us to do. A year before, they were ready for the war, I believe. A year before, we used to make from paper those. Remember, Roman, we used to make it, and he was in the army. He's supposed to come home in September, and he wasn't. They told us about the war because they wanted so much that corridor, maybe heard of the corridor.
Oh, dancing.
Yeah, dancing, the corridor. And dancing, they had another city, Gdynia, I don't know if you heard of it. That was the Polish part because they knew that someday they'll take away. So we knew that will be a war because he wants the corridor. And Poland, without the corridor, they would be without the sea. They would have to pay for every little bit to go through, you know. They didn't have any oranges. No, orange didn't grow in Poland. And oranges, bananas, the citrus fruit didn't grow in Poland. I guess we heard so a lot about the war.
So when it first started then, how did you hear on the radio?
The sirens were, you heard sirens, people were screaming in the streets. And I came home and my parents weren't happy either, but they didn't know what's going to happen to the Jews. Because they lived through the First World War and they didn't bother the Jewish people, not the Germans. They didn't like the Poles because they were any little thing they blamed the Jew for. But they didn't expect something would happen.
Were there any Jews that you remember who thought that maybe the Germans would be better than the Poles?
I don't know. No. There were the same day or the next day, people went, this I remember, they said that they'll hurt us, the youth. And they won't do anything to the parents, to the, my father was, I don't know, maybe he was 50 at that time. But the youth is very in danger. So everybody ran to Warsaw, from Łódź to Warsaw. So the Germans, a lot of Jewish people went there. So they came and they shut them down with machine guns. They even shot a little girl on the pasture with a cow. The Germans, right away they showed those things. That was maybe 2 or 3 days when the war was on. The war started on Friday, September the 1st. And I remember Sunday we went a street Marishin, that was the way to go to Warsaw. They supposed to walk to Warsaw. It was 120 miles, but somehow they want to go there because Warsaw was still under the Poles. And Lodz was already, I don't know, we didn't hear anything. They just crossed over the border, no resistance whatsoever. They just went straight to Lodz. And at that time, everybody, whoever could come back to Łódź, and there were a lot of dead people already. That was 2-3 days when the war was on.
Any bombs fall? Did you ever bomb?
They did not bomb. Łódź. They named Łódź Litzmannstadt afterwards, during the when they occupied it. Łódź was a very industrial city. They took out all the best things. There were a lot of factories there. It was the richest man was a Jew. I don't know if you heard, if you people. A Poznański had a palace. He had a hospital. He had he was a very rich man. There were 35,000 people working in at Poznański's. And I heard that they took everything, whatever was nice and good, they took out. They supposed to leave Poland as agriculture, a farmland, like peasants. They considered the Poles the prime people, under people, yeah. The Jews were their competitors, but the Poles were the prime people.
Now, when they did they march into Łódź? Did the Germans march in?
Oh yeah, they did.
Do you remember? Did you see them march in? Yes, I saw.
And we had some German neighbors. The whole time they called themselves Poles. We didn't know that they were Germans, but they were Volksdeutsches. Yeah, and they said, "Look at the army. Look at the." Unfortunately, the Polacks didn't have anything. I don't remember seeing trucks with soldiers. They had horse and wagons, I believe. And the Germans marched in, and they were very much. They had a lot of trucks and cars and whatever, tanks, I don't know, they were very much, they didn't have as much as the United States, they were very inferior to the United States, but compared to Poland, they were advanced.
Do you remember what you thought when you saw them come in?
I was young, I didn't know, we didn't know, nobody knew what will happen to the Jewish people, just other people are coming, that's all.
How did their family respond to all this? What was their initial reaction?
Well, it was frightening, but they still didn't believe that something like this could happen to the Jewish people. Because the Germans were ready. The Jewish people were under the Germans during the First World War, I believe.
Did anybody in your family say, let's go?
Some people went to Russia, but my mother didn't want to go. I don't remember if my father said the Russians are the brutal people and the Germans are the civilized people. They won't hurt us. Where will we go? We nobody knew that. You heard about things. People came from Zbonsin to Łódź, but they sent them out to Poland. They were supposed to be Polish citizens, so they sent them back to Poland. Nobody believed that something like this could happen.
So, do you remember then people who had been sent, deported from Germany?
Yes.
Who had come
to Poland, yeah.
Did anyone you knew or any members of your family who came?
No, but they were neighbors of ours. They were very advanced people, nice people.
What did they tell you about Germany?
Oh, they were very, very much Germans. They said they're going to go back. The minute the war ends and Hitler will get out of there, they're going to go back. That was their fatherland.
Do you remember when they came?
When they come? They came shortly before the war, I believe.
38.
Yeah, they came.
Well, tell me what you remember about your experiences in Łódź after the ghetto.
Well, the minute they came in, that was in October, they right away, they start showing. They didn't allow Jews to, there were lines for bread, and the Jew wasn't allowed to stay in the line for bread. you know, the bakeries were right away, no bread, no stores, nothing, you know, war is, everything is taken away by them. They put in commissars, like managers in Jewish business. They put in a manager and they threw out the Jew in the big stores in the business. They took over all the, whatever they could, they took over, whatever it was. Even when they put us in the ghetto, I remember, they used to come with big trucks, and there were some Jews, like you said, couples, that they told them, they paid people to tell where things are. So I remember they used to come trucks they were apartments, people used to live in apartments mostly. They came there and into cellars, and they took out leather and warm, and because during the war they need warm clothes and leather and all those.
These were Jews that were being paid, that they were.
I guess so. There must have been Jews to tell them where things are, or jewelry. When somebody had a diamond, if some people told them that, let's believe what's here, a popular Jewish name, a common Jewish name. How do you?
You mean a last name?
Yeah, last name.
Cone.
A cone, yeah. When one cone had a diamond, how many cones there were, they took them in the Kriminalpolizei, in the police station. And they hit all of them, you have to give me your diamonds. But some of them were so poor, they didn't have any diamonds. But they used to work over people so badly. Even if a person didn't have any diamonds, he was hurt. He got beaten up because he didn't give them the diamonds.
These were the police.
That was the German police. The
German police.
Yeah, the Kriminalpolizei, Kripo, for sure.
SS.
No, that's... But there were so many, right, there were... Right. Schupo and Kripo and Staatspolizei was, it must have been Schipo, yeah. And, those were by the beginning. They took four people and they hung in the middle of a square. And there were maybe 5 or 10 squares in Łódź. It was a big city. And they took out the people. People had to go and see that they're this one committed a crime, that's why hang. You have to tell the truth to the German government, to the German police, otherwise you're going to be like him.
How did they get you out to see all this?
Our police came, German police came, you had to go out of the house
they
and see.
Call with loudspeakers?
Loudspeakers, so they used to go into the houses, yeah.
Do you remember... when they began to pass laws about public transportation, not letting
Jews ride? Oh, it was right away. Being in Poland, anti-Semitic, automatically, even a German didn't recognize you, a Pole would say, that's a Jew. Automatically was like that the Jew wasn't allowed to stay in line for bread, the Jew wasn't allowed to go here, the Jew wasn't allowed to go any place.
Were there curfews?
Oh yeah, there was a curfew. When you have war, there's a curfew. 5 o'clock, you have to be home.
Did Poles have to be off the street too?
I imagine there were Poles off the street, yeah.
What about the armbands? Remember when they passed the order that the Jews had to wear armbands?
Oh, the armbands. That was right away. It was also maybe in October. Yeah, we had to wear armbands. By the beginning was blue, David Star, armband with a David Star, but the beginning was blue. Jewish doctors used to wear a yellow band with a red cross. Again, in Łódź, when they made the ghetto, there were big streets that a connection with smaller towns, like... here, how can I compare it? Greenfield, let's say. Or even bigger streets, because they went to smaller towns. So they made bridges. They made wires around so the Jews could walk inside. And to go from one street to another, you had to cross over a bridge. I believe in Łódź they still have those bridges there. There were three bridges. Yeah.
Do you remember the Bayuti district?
What?
Bayuti.
Bayuti, yeah. There was a square in the where the Jews supposed to live.
This is where the ghetto was?
Yeah, the ghetto, Bayuti, yeah.
Do you remember when how did you find out about the ghetto, that the ghetto was being started?
Where there were announced signs. Yeah, they went into the Jewish center, like, and they said they took a man, and he was the oldest man. You're gonna be the Judenoldest, and that's, and they told him everything, and they made signs. And
do you remember who that was?
Oh yeah, Rumkowski. He was a very bad guy. The brother was a doctor. He was an aristocrat, but he was a very bad man. He wasn't good to the Jews. They burned him alive in Auschwitz, I believe, the Jewish. He was a bad man, period.
Did you ever see him?
Yes, I have seen him. I saw him when the ghetto started. He was skinny and old, broken down man. And he was for 4 years in the ghetto. He got big and fat, and he had a lot of girlfriends. He was a very bad guy.
Was there a Judenrat in them?
Judenrat, yeah.
And he was the head of the Judenrat?
Yes, he was the Judenältest.
Did you know any other members of the Judenrat?
That was to 1942 from 40. And then later, was also a power struggle, was another man, Gertler. He was like, how do you say, like Jewish mafia, something like that. He used to be poor, as a poor Jew before the war. And he was like a mafia before the war. But somehow he was better for the Jewish people than that Rumkowski. Well, his brother was a doctor, and he was in a Jewish orphanage, I believe. He was managing a Jewish orphanage or whatever. How do you want the oldest from a Jewish orphanage? How do you want to call it? A director, yeah. In a Jewish orphanage. And I was working in a kindergarten as a helper to a teacher, because I didn't have that. I was only not quite 17. And they talked a lot about him. He wasn't good. Jewish people didn't know how to take care of food. You know, Jewish people were business people, big business people.
Merchants
from clothing and everything. And they used to buy food from the grocers, from the farmers. And he was storing food, and they weren't succeeding. The winters were very cold. The potatoes froze, the carrots, potatoes, and people were dying like flies. There wasn't any food in the city. The snow was on the floor and on the ceiling, and you had to live like that. We used to, the first year when we were there in the ghetto, we used to burn the little furniture that we had. And then later we used to burn the fences, anything that was wooden, that was usable, we burned it. And not only my brother did, or I did, but all the neighbors did it. And then there were houses, we were afraid to go with the border streets, because the Germans, whenever they felt like it, they were shooting. There was one, he had red hair, they used to call him the Gaeler. He used to shoot whenever he was drunk. He saw anybody, like a doctor that used to wear a yellow band. He was untouchable. He was shooting on doctors too. He killed doctors. He killed anybody that crossed the bridge. So we used to go through, just knock out. The apartments were so big. There were four-story buildings, but there were big squares around and around, so we used to knock out, walls and go from street to street inside, so the Germans wouldn't see us.
You moved when the ghetto was established. Do you remember when the ghetto began?
In March, 1940 in March. I don't know exactly what day, but then they just made the...
And you moved to the Baluti district at
yes,
that time?
Yes.
How did the orders come to you?
As I told you, they told us...
The Germans came to the building that you were living in? And
no, there was a kiosk. What's it?
A kiosk.
Achtung. Achtung. Attention. And there were a written thing, and that day you have to be here and here, and that's it.
Did anybody think of not doing it?
One teacher asked me that. How could you not do it when they're staying with dogs and with rifles?
So then the day came and they were there with dogs and rifles.
Right.
Was there a place to live ready for you there? Did you?
Yes, I told you. My mother rented a room in the ghetto. And we supposed to go. And the night before she said, take something. And a rucksack.
It was planned. Everything was planned ahead of time.
Yeah, you had to, otherwise they would put you in the street, so they went...
The section where the Poles has to leave those houses.
Yeah, the Poles left and we came.
And the Jews, they had prepared before those rooms.
Yeah, they came there and they paid a little bit, I don't know what money my mother paid. I told you, the next day we came, it wasn't any home, any father, any mother, nobody. They took them, they cut off all streets and took the people and they shot them. Excuse me.
Do you remember a man named Moser? Dr. Moser?
In Łódź?
In Łódź. He was a German official.
Bibov.
Bibov. I remember Hans Bibov.
Yeah. Yeah, Bibov.
What do you remember about Hans Bibov?
I didn't see him, but I heard of him.
Did the orders come from him?
Yes.
The governor,
right. And now where did he give the orders?
I don't know. There was written on the thing.
On the walls.
On the walls.
Yeah,
on the kiosk, on the walls.
What was his relationship with Rumkowski?
Rumkowski pleased him. That's what I want to tell you. He pleased him. He was petrified. He was scared of him. Which that Gertler, nobody mentioned this. Did you interview people from Łódź?
Sure.
And nobody knew about Gertler?
Not Gertler.
Well, I was working with Gertler's cousin. And that Gertler was much... He was a mafia. He knew how to please them. And first of all, he rationalized and he gave it away right to the people. Let the people hide themselves. Let them preserve themselves the food. That was the good point. And then secondly, he gave them whiskey. He was more of a comrade chef because he was himself a mafia, so he knew how to deal with the Germans, I guess. He wasn't maybe too nice of a guy. I heard that he survived. He's alive. He was alive, I heard, right after the war. I don't know what happened to him now. What did he do before the war, Roman? You knew of Gertler. When people couldn't pay taxes or something. You didn't hear of him? When people couldn't pay taxes. That was in Poland before the war. I heard of that during the war. And he used to come and... Yeah, on auctions. On auctions he used to buy for pennies that people used to work their whole lives. It used to cost $1,000, so he used to buy it for $10.
Underworld.
Yeah, mafia-like.
I see. And he opposed Rumkowski?
Yes, there was a power struggle and he took over. In the last 2 years, we had it a little better under that Gertler than under Rumkowski.
And Rumkowski, he left? He was
He was still there. He was still in the lodge, I believe, because he left with us. Yes, and not only one. It's terrible when you think back. People were dying from hunger, and the youngest, prettiest, and the most intelligent girls had to be his secretaries. And after a month or two or three, he sent them out, gave them. One of his girlfriends was managing the place that I worked in 1940 or 41. Yeah.
What were you doing when you were working?
Oh, I was playing with the kids. We had 35 kids and playing, singing songs, and that was during the summer month. This was from June to. I met at that time Jewish women from the UNRWA. Mm-hmm. From the. Some, I think there were two Jewish women, and they said nothing will happen to the Jewish kids. That was 1940. Nothing will happen. We are here. We are. That they are providing the food. It was a little better food at that time for the children. That was in 1940, I believe. When did the United States declare war on Germany? 41, yeah.
Now, did the men, when they began the ghetto, what did they demand of Jews in the ghetto?
Well, we were like a family. We were in a family. Well, I didn't have any more the parents, but we were with the two brothers. But next to us was a neighbor, was a husband and wife and two daughters. There were families there in the ghetto. And we worked, and we came back and...
You worked for the Germans?
Yes.
Now, this orphanage that you worked for, or this kindergarten. Was this a Jewish kindergarten?
Yes, it was in the ghetto.
So the Jewish community organized it?
Yes, the Jewish kids. I believe teachers did it, yeah. Teachers and because my...
Were there institutions, the Zionist groups or socialist groups from before the war who took over during the ghetto and supplied food and education?
Well, I don't think so.
So it was a group of teachers got together?
Teachers, yeah. I think there were teachers.
What were some of these groups? What did the Zionists do in the ghetto was formed?
By the beginning, in 1940, they didn't like to be closed up. I remember they went to the doors. It was like I told you that doors that you could pass when the traffic wasn't too big or something. And the Jewish people didn't want to stay in the ghetto. And at that time, the first summer, I believe, there was unrest. And the men started fighting with them. But the Jewish police fought them.
The Jewish police?
Yes, the Jewish police with, how do you call it?
Trench.
With guns.
Truncheons?
Yeah, with those clubs, yeah. And that's all what I heard. I remember I was working at that time, and another friend of my girlfriend came, and around our camp, and our that summer camp, were Jewish police. Jewish, they were young students. They were better off than the rest of the people. I don't know. And he told us that he was hitting some people. And we were sitting, I remember my girlfriend and I, and we were asking him, whom did you hit, Jews? So he got red, he stopped doing that. But the Jewish police were paid by the Rumkowski. Rumkowski was the bad guy. That's all what I can tell you. He, everything what the Germans told him, he did very consciously, religiously. He followed their orders.
There were was he responsible for the rationing of food?
Yes, they were responsible for rationing of the food
and
for everything.
Issuing talons? You remember the talons?
What talons did we have? The biggest jobs was what I was doing. They had Marishin. Did you hear of a Marishin? It was another camp. They were there, sleeping there and everything. That was the whole... And there were kitchens and there were swords that you went to sew for the Germans. My sister was working in a knit shop. That was after 42. It was a Spera. They took all the sick people and old and children and took them away. We didn't know at that time they're supposed to be killed. And the ones who can work would stay in the ghetto at that time. I remember I was working at that time in the kitchen. They closed up the kindergarten, the camps. And near where I was working, this was a factory from, how do you say, Przędzalnia? Yarns, a yarn factory. And from that yarn, they made materials, textiles, a textile factory. And near that was a hospital. I don't know to whom that hospital belonged. And that was in 1942. We saw people running away from the hospital. It was terribly frightening. It was a little house. And they ran into that house where I was working. And ran, and they told us they take away sick people. And we didn't know where they take them away. At that time, we went home. And we didn't know about those things. Aspera and Germans with dogs and Jewish police went from house to house, from room to room, to get out the old and the sick and the kids. That was about in September, before Jewish holidays, they used to make the most atrocious things.
Was the ghetto getting smaller physically? Were they closing it in?
Oh, well, if people were dying, no, they didn't make smaller the territory. They sent in people from the smaller cities.
All Jews?
All Jews. They even sent in German Jews, too, from Prague, Czechoslovakian Jews. And from Prague, from all over, I think from Germany, to Łódź in schools. Where schools used to be. And they were dying like flies, the German Jews. They couldn't stand it. The cold, the weather there in Poland was colder too than in Germany, I guess.
Was there any disease?
Diseases? Yes, must have been. I wasn't sick, but there were a lot of typhoid going around because of the hygienic and no food, no medicine, nothing.
What were the hygienic conditions like?
Terrible, terrible. Men, you couldn't recognize people. If you knew them before the war, you saw them. I was working with a lady there in the camp. She was the Polish correspondent in Vienna. She was highly educated. She was sent out from Poland to Vienna. She was the correspondent for Poland. And I saw her. This could have been maybe 2 years later. She was wearing rags. She was the face. It's unrecognizable. I saw a young man that I knew before the war. He came. I was lucky. I was working in that kitchen for 2 years. Automatically, they send us. From the camp, from the children, they sent us there. And a young man, they used to have a beautiful shoe store, like Chandler's Shoes. And he was also a college, I don't know, graduate, or he was a student. And he was just unbelievable how he looked. It was just like that, like you see the skeletons in the street.
This was in 1942?
That was 43, most probably in the 40s in the ghettos.
You said they were dropping like flies.
Dying people, hundreds.
People were dying
hundreds,
in the streets.
Yeah.
You remember seeing people die in the streets?
Not exactly, but in the houses you saw the how they call the, like you have here the Ira Kaufman's, Chesed Shlemes. They used to come and pick up dead people from the houses.
From funeral parties.
From funeral valleys, I don't know.
They death brigades.
Yeah, to the rooms and took out people. People that you saw a day before or something, you saw taking them out. That was.
And were there the corpses in the streets that you saw?
Not, I didn't see that.
It was planned because you worked.
I worked, yeah, they were in the city, but I worked, I went to work. We worked 12 hours a day. We went in the morning, came at night home. And just to bring something home, I a piece of, how do you call it, kohlrabi, carrots, to bring home for my brother so he would be able to go to work to stay on his feet, a potato. And the whole thing was just to survive, just to survive.
And you were living in this apartment?
In that room. It was one room.
One room. And how many were you in the room?
Four people, and there would be six if they were my parents. Sure, you couldn't afford a bigger place because they put all the Jews there.
And your aunts, what had happened?
My other aunt also had one room. There was near my aunt. Their families, but they were all like this. You had a room and you were staying there. The next door to us was a family of, parents and two daughters. They were all in one room. You couldn't afford at that time.
Were your brothers working during the day?
My younger brother grew so much. He got sick and he died because we didn't have any food. He grew. He was 15, and at that time was the dangerous age. But my older brother was the whole time with us to 1944, and when they took us to Auschwitz.
And you had another brother too?
No, two brothers.
Just two brothers. Yes. But were they on labor gangs? Did the Germans come and take labor gangs?
Yes, they took them to work. My younger brother, that was before the ghetto. They took him to work and they beat him up. He had to dig a ditch. And I think maybe since then he didn't feel good. And they beat up so much that he was a young boy. My older brother, once they caught him to work, two Germans caught him and they asked him to polish their shoes. And every time he polished the shoes, they beat him with what. But he survived until 44, and I didn't hear. One of my friends told me that she saw him 1945. It could have been maybe a week or 2 weeks before the war ended. And I didn't hear from him since then.
Were you there when the ghetto was liquidated?
Yes. They were maybe a couple of weeks or months later. But we went out on August the 10th. They took us to Paryshin. What was that? There was a jail there. I forgot the name of. How do you call that? Did you call the jail there? Ruth Levin remembered better than.
Sorry, so they took you to a jail first?
Yeah. I don't know, to concentrate all people together. So I guess that was not Maryshin, it has another name, I forgot.
I have one quick question before this. Do you remember a strike of some sort in August 1944? Jewish workers refused to go. Did anything like that ever happen?
I left August the 10th, maybe afterwards.
And Rumkowski had something to do with that.
Rumkowski was for it or against?
Was against it.
Was against. He was always with the Germans.
Yeah,
he was always pleased them very much. So.
Had you ever heard of Kumhoff before? At all, or Helmno?
Helmno. That was.
That's the Polish for the Kumhoff.
Yeah. Helmno.
Had you heard of that?
Yes, I heard in Łódź, in Poland, that the gas chambers. I heard that some of my cousins were there, Treblinka, Majdanki.
But before the ghetto was liquidated, did anyone in the ghetto know about Chełmno or Treblinka?
We didn't. We really didn't. There was the Jewish fire department, fire and police, the fire where I was working in the kitchen. They maybe a couple of months before they liquidated the ghetto, that could have been July or in June, they had a list. They took anybody, whoever was on the list. My brother was at that time on the list. And they came to the house in the middle of the night, Jewish police, and they took out the people. So we hid at that time. Anyhow, that man told us, I said, if they take my brother, I'll go with my sister and I. And he said, don't. Let at least one survive of you. That the Polish workers, what are they called? Today we don't have it because we have airplanes. On the depot, how do you call it? The train workers. The train workers told them, don't go. Fight them back. Don't go. It was just, people were saying, they were a Jewish people. They had radios hidden in the basements. I remember one man had a radio hidden, but somebody denounced him. Somebody, police came in the middle of the night, arrested him. I guess German police, and they shot him or they hurt.
Did any Poles ever help?
No. Did a Pole help you during the war or no? No. They were pointing out the Jews. Yeah, they. Not in the big cities. They right away they used to be your friends, and they pointed out the Germans. That was in October and September, even before they gave the orders to do those. So
you were never helped by any. Was there any resistance that you knew of in the ghetto? Underground?
I only remember that one time. That was in 1940 in summer. I remember I heard of it. I wasn't there because I was working. That the Jewish people didn't like to be put in the ghettos, and how it happened, how they crushed the resistance, I don't know.
There was no talk of fighting?
No.
The
Jews didn't have any. We didn't have any ammunition. We were closed up in a place. How could you? France fell in 3 weeks. How could you fight with? And then the news used to come. People had hidden the radios or something. If the Russians, they are in war with Russia. They're here. They're there. Somehow the news came around, and they used to. Would you like a coffee? Would you like to stop? I couldn't. I have that hypoglycemia. I have to have an orange once. We had a girlfriend when we left Łódź to Auschwitz, and we saved her a couple of times. She lost her arm in the factory. Beautiful girl. You know, nobody checked how the machines, or they're good or bad, and she lost her arm there. And by the selections, we had to take off our clothes, you know, you heard of. So we were holding arms, like one arm and the other, so we would camouflage her. And the German doctor, the soldier, I don't know who he was, and he walked. And every four people, we were standing four people, and he noticed her. She went through maybe three times. The fourth time he picked her up without the arm, they sent her to the gas chamber.
Can I just go back for a second on some of the a couple of things in the ghetto? Right. The ghetto was barbed wire.
So right.
Were there ever any gypsies who were sent to the ghetto?
No, we didn't see gypsies until we went to the camp. I haven't seen any gypsies in the ghetto.
Do you remember what kind of rumors did you heard? Were there rumors all the time in the streets about what was going to happen,
yes,
where they were going?
There were rumors. There were also news rumors that the United States declared war on them, and there were rumors they are fighting the Russians, and they have casualties on the Russian on the Eastern Front. It was a city full of poets and writers. We sang songs about idealistic things, about Churchill, about politics. People were talking. You couldn't help it but hear it. But nobody knew for sure what's happening.
What did people think about where the members of their family, the Jewish community, had gone?
Well, some people thought that they sent them to small towns. We didn't know. And even if we would know, what can you do with their hands?
I'm just wondering what kind of things they thought. For example, what did you think had happened to your parents?
They took them to a small town someplace. They cut off the streets and took them to a small town. But nobody knew for sure where they are, what they are.
Now, you said they took you to a prison.
I can't remember that. And Marishim, someplace was a thing that you had to go through until you went on the train. Yeah, we were on trains. Sent.
Cattle cars?
Those were call trains, open trains. I guess it must have been a small train to take us to the big train, yeah.
I see. And where did you get the other train?
On a station, I don't even remember the place. How did we get in on the closed trains? There was a cattle car. And we went from Łódź to Auschwitz. It took us a whole night. And it isn't too far. About 12, 13 hours when we arrived to Auschwitz.
How many people were in there?
Who knows? There were maybe 100 people.
It was crowded.
Yeah, very crowded.
Do you have any food?
They did give us a piece of bread.
And water?
No, not the 13 hours. We didn't need any water. It was at night. In the morning we arrived to Auschwitz. And I'll never forget that Auschwitz.
When the doors opened up.
Yeah.
What do you remember about
it? The Czechs were wearing stripes. They also were Jews, Czech Jews. Picked us up, and I wanted to pick up my purse. I had a nice purse I made myself, a cloth purse. It was in August, so in the summertime when I came home, I made myself a purse. And I said it at that time in Polish, let me get my purse. And the Czechoslovakian boy said, I didn't know that the Polish Jews are that stupid. And I didn't know why I'm so stupid that I want to pick up my purse. That we don't need the purses, you understand? That was the stupidity. He couldn't say that we were so ignorant or naive or something, so he said it's stupid. And on the way, we marched again, four people in a row. On the way, there were already Polish Jews there, and they used to tell us, eat up, they'll take away things from you. Eat up, do you have diamond rings? Give it to me, because they'll take away anyhow from you.
These were other Jews.
These were other Jews working on the streets, and we were there. They took off our clothes, they shaved off our hair, you've probably heard of it. They didn't check if you were clean or dirty, they just shaved off everybody's hair. And we went to be bathed, and yeah, my brother came with us from Łódź. And I remember when they separated us, my brother said, after the bath, I'm going to see you. They took men separately and women. Or if I don't see you, write to uncle. We had an uncle in South America. And that's the last time I saw. But I saw somebody from our city, from Piotrkow, in that camp in Auschwitz. And I told him who I am, and I told him my brother is there with the man. Remember, give him, they took away everything from us. Give him something to eat or something, I told him. He said, I'm going to look for him the next, I never saw that guy again. We were 14 days there. They just took away our belongings, and they took us. And every day we had Zählappels. They used to wake us up 4 o'clock in the morning. We used to stay in line, and then they come and counted us. And every day they used to look us up and look if we had any little thing, if anybody had a little pimple or something, you know what they did. In the last minute, I have a younger sister. She was at that time 19, 44, she was 15, and she was young, but somehow she had a round face, and they gave her a dress, something like it was good for her because it covered her up so much and her face looked fuller. And the German let her go on the right side to work. And another, that's a man, a German, he must have been attacked or something, I don't know, he was wearing a uniform, came to her and he asked her, another woman, a German woman, asked her, how old are you? And she said, 18, it's in German, 18. And she asked her, what year were you born? And she said, 1926. She looked at her and she said, you figured it out fast. Das schnell ausgerechnet. She didn't believe her, but they let her go. She didn't believe her. She said, you figured it out. She didn't say that you are that age. And another one, there were some Jews there. They were a long time there. They probably had it a little better than we did, you know. Was one Czechoslovakian. She had red hair. She used to beat up people. She was a Jew, Czechoslovakian Jew. She used to beat up. She's supposed to be hanged, and then somehow she was saved, so she was working for the Germans, collaborating with the Germans. She used to beat up so badly people, we heard of it. And
is she a capo? Black Altus?
I don't know what she was there. She was a Black Altus, yeah. She was, whatever she did, she was screaming and yelling, and they all had like hoarse voices. It was like just like you would be in hell. Did you have pictures, life in hell? It was like that. The scream, sometimes when I go in the summertime in the beauty shop, and did you ever see how people color their hair? I feel that I'm in the camp there. It's a feeling, it's a horrible feeling. By the beginning, I used to go to a school, I don't know if you heard, Arnold's beauty shop, beauty school. People look there like they would be, the screaming, the yelling, and then their hoarse voices, and the. And we were there 14 days, and they sent us out to Bergen-Belsen. We didn't know where they sent us out. We were 4 days and four nights on the, in cattle wagons in the train. They took us, and then it was a place, Williamshafen or something. They took off one wagon, and they went to work there in the ammunition factory, and they didn't want to accept them. They asked, they told, they were Germans, and they told them that they don't look like human beings. They asked, where is your luggage? Where are your suitcases? And they said, we don't have any suitcases. They took everything away from us. So they sent them back to Bergen-Belsen, because they came back to our camps and they told us that they didn't want to accept us. They were ashamed with the Germans. That was on the French border. On the German-French border someplace.
Now, before you went to, you were in Auschwitz for 14 days.
Yeah.
Did you hear then of gas chambers?
Yes.
How did you hear about?
Well, it was in the middle of that barrack was like a horse barrack. On one side were those up and down camp bags, how do you call those, bunk beds?
Yeah.
There were maybe 15 in one place, not one, nothing to lay down on the bare floors. And on the other side was also the same thing, and in the middle was that oven that they supposed to burn the people. And the men who were fixing the streets told us, they told the mothers who came with little children. I had a lady friend that I worked with in the ghetto, in that children's camp. They told her, give away your children and you go on the side, but she didn't. I never saw that woman later. She didn't want to give away the children. She went with her children.
You remember the smells in the camp?
Yes, I told you how it smelled, how it looked. It's like hell.
Like hell.
I just can't picture hell like this, that's all.
What, for those 14 days, you would wake, they'd wake you at 4 in the morning?
Yeah, Sailor Pal.
Mm-hmm. And then what would happen during the day?
And then we went back, and they gave us something to eat. Piece of bread or something. Some of our girls were so. I was working in the kitchen. We didn't have enough food. The manager didn't let us have any privileges. But you could go in and see where it was laying to take a carrot, a piece of kohlrabi. I don't know if you know what kohlrabi is. A yellow. And eat that he didn't see. But we didn't have too good. But I guess I wasn't so like an animal hungry. That I survived that Auschwitz. Some of the girls, they were so hungry, and the Germans went by, they took anything they had in their hands to pick up some food. They were so hungry from Łódź. They digged into, and they didn't care if they're gonna be beaten up or anything. They were hungry.
Do you remember any punishments?
Oh yeah.
Were you punished while you were there for anything?
Well, I was punished if you didn't go straight. With a cane or something, they hit you. And some of the girls went to. I didn't do it, but if a girl went to pick up a potato and. For the winter, you know, they didn't have what they have here. They used to put in potatoes, and on top of potatoes, straw, I believe, and on the top of the straw, dirt. How do you call those? Copiates, Roman. How is in English copiates?
Well,
I should
storage.
Storage for the potatoes, but it was on the outside. If a girl went there and picked up a potato like that, they beat her up and they put her in the middle. You know who was? One of the lady's sister went through something. And 4 weeks before the war ended, they cut off her hair again. From August until the war ended in April, we had already hair almost as big as my husband's and mine now. A little shorter, but we had hair. And they cut off her hair because of picking up a potato.
Was anybody hung or shot while you were there? Which was hung?
During
escape, there was shot.
Yeah, during.
There were attempts at escape.
Oh yeah.
Not or in that camp where I was in the girl all girls camp. Yeah, all girls camp. I don't know. We were holding ourselves. But from that was Bergen-Belsen. From Bergen-Belsen to the labor camp, it was maybe 6 weeks, but. Not to have any food and not to have any clothes, it were long 6 weeks, you know, relatively the time. So I remember we were hungry and we came there maybe the end of August. So we were in a tent. There wasn't a house or anything, and straw was underneath.
What was the name of the camp?
Bergen-Belsen.
Oh, this is a Belsen, not the
Belsen, okay. Bergen-Belsen, yeah. We were in a tent camp, in a tent, like, house. And we were laying here and here, people and there. But in the same camp, that wasn't as bad as Auschwitz, because they didn't beat us up at that time. They didn't beat the Zellappel. They let us sleep a little longer. We didn't go out 4 o'clock in the morning. And the people they cooked for us were French. They had houses like, they had like barracks. But we were in a tent. Yeah, in a tent.
Do you remember any names of any of the guards or the commandants of the camps?
I don't remember. One of them was shot, that was in the labor camp. He was shot, a young American, young boy shot him. He wanted to run away. They didn't introduce themselves.
No, did they talk to the prisoners?
No, they just came and did what they had to do and left.
Just they gave orders.
Gave orders, and
beat up.
Yeah, whatever supposed to be done. That was in Bergen-Belsen. From Bergen-Belsen to Salzwedel was the camp that I was liberated. It was 6 weeks, and it was also maybe 100 kilometers, maybe 60, at most 80 miles from Bergen-Belsen to that labor camp. Also, a German came and he selected girls. So, being already for so many years, we knew that if he selected some strong, healthy girls, so you go there. Wherever they go, you go. And my sister had a cold and she had a sore throat. And I helped her dress, and by helping her dressing, I saw that he's sending over people to on that side. I said, well, am I that stupid to go to him? I don't know if he's going to let her through. She has a call. So I stood there, and it took us a whole night. Again, they gave us a little more. They gave us at that time that striped coat. We had only a dress and one pair of underwear. That's all they gave us. And I think a pair of shoes. And we went to that Salzwedel, to that labor camp.
Your sister too?
My sister too, yeah. And on the way, my sister felt terrible. She thought that her neck, her throat is closing up. And she told me, I won't make it, I can't. She had a fever, she had a blister on her face. I was in my house. I was 45, maybe 22, I don't know. And I said, what to do? I was older than her, but I was still young to know what to do. You can't complain to a German, to anybody, that she's sick, because they would send her back. So I tell this, do you want to step on the floor? She used urine, her own urine, to burn through her. It was terrible. She was crying the whole night. And an elderly lady, she was maybe 35 years old, she told her to do it or she won't survive. And she did it. She used her own urine to
clear the throat.
To clear the throat. And she still had a blister on, and I don't know how I got a piece of cloth. I probably saw someplace in the kitchen or something. And I was afraid to put on her neck so they'll see that she's sick. So it was long enough that she put on her whole head and the neck. And that's why it was already probably in November, because I remember it was a cold, rainy day. And they kept us the whole day on your feet, straight from the train. And they sent us right away to work, to the night shift. They didn't let us rest, go to sleep or anything.
Where were you working?
In ammunition factory.
Yes.
And we worked there. We worked there for November, December to March. In March, the American bombed. I don't know if it was American bombs or English or Russian bombs. They bombed the factory too. So we didn't go anymore there. We didn't have any food. We had 3 times a day, only water and water and water. Yeah, in the same camp as we were, there were men working, and the men were French soldiers. There were civilians when we were there, but they told us later and then that they are soldiers. They were captured as prisoners of war, and they were working in the ammunition factory. In the same city or small town, whatever it was, were Jewish French soldiers who they were wearing uniforms. They didn't want to give up their uniform because they were afraid that they would be Jews. At least they had a uniform, so they belonged to the Geneva camp, to any international Red Cross or anything. And between those French Jews, there were maybe 150 of those people. There were maybe 100 Polish Jews. One was a doctor, a Polish Jew, a doctor from someplace near Łódź. And he came to the hospital. We had a little hospital there, like an ambulance or something. That if somebody got sick or something hurt, they took us there. And I came there, and that Jewish doctor took over, and he he brought bread, and they gave away their Red Cross packages to the Germans. The Germans at that time, they took out their wine and chocolate and cigarettes, I believe that was the, and they gave us the rest. And I think thanks to that we are alive, because you couldn't survive 3 months without food. And the French men were very nice to us. They weren't allowed to talk to us. The Germans used to say, nicht unterhalten sich, not to talk, even to a man there. So they used to bring a sandwich or a baked potato and put in the wastebasket and told us, I put the potato in the wastebasket, go take it. The French men used to tell us. And those people, they worked day and night. They went to, we didn't have any stockings to wear, and it was winter time still. They used to go and buy and sell whatever they had and buy stockings and bring us into the camp, the Jewish French soldiers. Most of them were Polish Jews. They it was there, they had a little carpet near shop, like here you have in the school shops that you do something. And we didn't have anything to wear, so we used to take our covers, the, how do you call the, no, oh, I forgot, it's so hard to say it in English, blankets. Mm-hmm. Blankets put on our head, take a piece of string, put here, we looked like the monks. And the people, they were still wearing uniforms, they look better than us, and they just want to see us. They used to go to their shop just to see us. And they used to talk to us. If we know somebody on that and that name, maybe their cousin or their sister is here with us, and talk to us and told us all kind of stories. Don't worry, the war is near the end, and you'll survive. And they gave us hope, and they did so much, and I think, thanks to them, we are alive, because we can't survive 3 months without any food.
Now, at the labor camp, there was only water? That's all they were giving you? Was this,
three times a day, like dirty water, like dish water, dishwasher.
Was this also run by the SS?
Yeah.
It wasn't the Wehrmacht, it was still the SS.
I guess so. Was that? Yeah, it was the SS, because he did wear the skull.
Do you remember in any of those camps that you were in, was there any religious services conducted?
No. Oh yeah, when we came there, my husband has a number, I don't have a number. So on a Sunday, it was in that labor camp, on a Sunday he came to us, a German. He walked funny. They said that he was shot on the Russian front, and if somebody was shot, then they gave them a job in a camp like this. And he told us that you are dogs now, you're not people anymore, you have a number. But they didn't put us a number, so they gave us a metal number. I have written someplace what was my number. I think 8990 or 8991, the 8000 something. You are dogs now, you're not people anymore. And we were happy that they didn't tattoo us. So who cares? We shouldn't throw away the number after the war. And after the war, we threw away the number. We had to wear it on our neck.
On a chain?
Yeah, not a chain, from a piece of string or something. I think a piece of lace. They checked us. We had to wear that during the time.
Even in the labor camp.
Right, yeah.
When you went, what kinds of living conditions were there? Kind of sanitary conditions?
No.
Nothing.
It was in the middle of that, a little house like outhouse. Yeah. And cold water, that you wash yourself up as much as you could. Hygienic, you have to forget it. As long as they would give us the food to survive, the inside. No heat in the barracks. We had a bunker bed, yeah. So I had one bed to sleep.
Did your sister get better?
Yes.
What happened to, after that?
After that, it just cleaned up. She doesn't like it when she hears of that, but that was an experience that if she wouldn't do it, she wouldn't be with us today. She had a sore here, and she was wearing that little thing, and she had beautiful black eyes, she had a beautiful face, and the French, somehow she was, the French, the workers who worked there were crying when they saw my sister, and they said, who knows what they're doing with our children? You know, they saw that she was such a youngster, and they put us right away to work and at night. In daytime, we slept maybe 2-3 hours. We had to go and clean the outside, clean, cook, do whatever they want. They didn't let us sleep more than 3-4 hours.
Were there the same kinds of punishments in the labor camp as in the... is in Auschwitz, say?
Well, we were working. They didn't have time, maybe, to do it.
But were people beaten as much?
Oh, yeah. If you do something what they don't like, they would beat you up. You had to understand and speak, I guess, German, because I was working at one time I was putting powder in the caps. One time I was working, it was a beautiful machine. That machine was measuring and weighing the bullets. They were already finished bullets. And on the night before me, in a different shift, or I was at daytime at that time working, in the night, a girl was killed because she didn't put on the safe. At the end, the bullet, the machine measured the little neck or something of the bullet. And I guess one came near the other or something did happen and shot out and got her straight in the stomach and killed her. So how did they came to me? They told me that, the German told me that. He asked me if I understand German, and I said yes. And he told me, don't forget to put on that safe. Yeah. If you don't, you're gonna lay like a dog, like you, a girl that worked on the same machine this night. You're gonna lay like a dog here. So I remember that, and I guess she was a Greek Jew, and she didn't understand what he was saying. She forgot to put down that, and got straight in her tummy.
Before, your husband mentioned that this is all very calculated, planned in the ghetto. Would you have called the German actions organized terror?
Sure, they were organized. They planned the whole thing. I don't know if they planned or they did as time went out, because I think the Poles provoked a lot to it too, because all the killing was on the Polish territory.
Why do you think that?
Because the helm and...
That's true. Why do you think they did all put the 6 death camps there?
Why did they do it? Because they didn't see any resistance from the population. Like in Holland, they went with the Jews, or Denmark, and the Poles are primitive people. And I don't know. The Jews used to run their country. Today, because they are so much in trouble, I think because they don't have the Jews there. We used to run their country, we used to bring fashion, we used to pay their taxes.
Do you remember how you felt, what your state of mind was in the camps?
Just to survive,
That's all what it was.
Did you worry about your parents, your brother? Did you wonder what was happening to them?
He didn't have the time. We were sure that we're going to meet, we're going to see our parents. I only knew that my younger brother died, younger than I. But the rest of them, they survived. My brother was smart. He was everything that a person can ask for. He was good looking. He was smart. He was fast. He was... I still can't believe that he perished.
Are there any things in particular that you remember that stand out? Other things that other than what you told me about your experiences in the camp?
We were hungry, and we were frightened.
Any specific incidents that you remember that happened to you or your sister, or that you saw happening to other people? You've told me several,
yeah,
right? So.
Yeah, there was enough. I don't know, at the moment, maybe next time, and if I remember something, I'll...
Had you heard of medical experiments? Did you ever hear the rumors of that?
They did in small places, in places like in small towns, but not in Łódź. There are too many people there.
Did you hear of it in Auschwitz?
No. We just heard that. Eat up, hide. You couldn't hide. I had a picture of my mother, and I wanted. It was a beautiful picture. She had her hair up, like by the beginning of the century, people were here with lace around. She thought I have gold or something. So she, a woman were over. I guess I was lucky. They didn't make any special experiments over on us.
Did you save anything? Pictures? Anything?
No.
No, you don't know where you go.
They took away everything from me.
Let me ask you what may be a foolish question.
Yeah.
But why do you think you survived?
I don't know. It's a question that you don't know. It happened, you survived, and that's it. I had a dream. I remember my sister was sick. No, that wasn't the time when she came from the... In order to save a day work, they used to keep us 14 days straight in a row, 14 nights straight. So they saved themselves a day or a night, you know, from Sunday to Monday. So she went to work, and she was only 15. She couldn't work 12 hours. So she fainted or something. So they took her to that little hospital, to that ambulance. And it was a doctor there, a Hungarian woman, a doctor. She called herself a doctor, who knows what she... And she gave her a pill or something. She gave me and I gave my sister, and then she told me to bring her over. So I brought her there, and excuse me, she threw up. Yet pill didn't agree with her or something. The pill was green or something. So she starts screaming to the doctor that she spit out her gallbladder. She thought so, the doctor thought so. And because of that reason, I don't know if she was a doctor, she called herself a doctor. You know, during the war you didn't have to show your credentials. Anyhow, she kept her there for a couple of days, for a day. Or day or night. And then after work I came to see her in that little hospital, and the place was so dirty. So I took a little water and I washed up the place near. It came to me, a woman that worked there, a Hungarian woman, actually. It was a terrible fight between the Hungarian Jews and the Polish Jews. Did anybody tell you that? And she told me, "Do you want your sister to be here? I'll give her Fleisch Suppe, that's
meat
soup, only the soup, the water, like chicken soup." And And she asked me to wash three floors, and they were so big. I don't know how I did it. I did it. And I remember, and at the same day, I had to go to work. And 2 o'clock, they gave us 15 minutes to sleep, and I slept on the near my machine. I was sleeping. I can't imagine the siren from the factory was, and I was still sleeping. And I remember the German walked me up. The 15 minutes, I was so tired, I guess, that I slept on the, they used to have those big boxes, a wooden box, and I slept on that box 15 minutes, and I had a dream, and I never forget that dream. That's something, I don't know if you want to believe in something or something, I never will forget that dream. I was dreaming that a day was like at night time, and the skies were full of clouds. And like you see sometimes, the moon goes under the cloud, and I saw, and this is supposed to be the sun. And I was dreaming, and I believe I was screaming because I couldn't hear myself. I was screaming in Polish at that time, "Sun, come to me, sun, come to me." They used to say, "The sun will shine for the Jewish kids." And the ghetto, we used to say that. And at that time, I saw a girl. Yeah, I was laying in the middle of a place. It was in Łódź. Yeah, I remember that dream. I was laying with a torn piece of clothes. And I saw people walk by me in beautiful evening gowns. In between those people, I noticed a girlfriend of my brother's walked by with a little black hat. Yeah, after that, what I was yelling and screaming, "Sun, come to me, come to me," I saw a beautiful day, a sunny day, and me laying on the floor in a little torn clothes, and I saw those people walking by in evening clothes. That could have been, I don't know, it could have been in January, a dream. I had a dream like that. And I was sleeping on that piece of wood, on that box, wooden box. And that was my dream that I remember. I never forget that dream. I was by myself, laying on the someplace on the square, and beautiful people walked by in beautiful clothes. Yeah, I didn't tell you how we survived. I didn't finish how we survived. For 3 months we had water and water 3 times a day, water. And we went to work, then later the factory was bombed, so we didn't go to work anymore. We had to go clean up the rebels, yeah. And at that time, maybe a week before the war ended, or 2 weeks before the war ended, they brought in common criminals to our camp. We had a number, a yellow piece, just a yellow piece of cloth on that coat. A yellow piece of cloth
around your arm.
On my arm, sewn on the sleeve. And a number. And then we had a red triangle. You know what the red triangle was? The Jews were communists, all Jews. A 10-year-old girl was a communist. So we were not only communist political offenders, yeah. And then the Germans, the common criminals, they had green offenders. They were thieves. They stole something. Most of them were Germans. Jews weren't thieves. And then there were black triangles. there were sex offenders, like a woman had an abortion, even if she was a German, if she did it, they put her in concentration camp. And gypsies, the first time we saw gypsies in our life. Did I see in Auschwitz gypsies? I don't believe I didn't, because I was only 14 days there. We saw men fixing the street. So this was maybe 2 weeks before. They dragged them from one city to another. If the Americans or the Russians or the English, if they came very close and they had the concentration camp people, they had prisoners of war or any prisoners, they dragged them into deep Germany, into Germany. And when we were 3 days before the Americans came in, the army came in, they cut off the water and the electric, the wires, I don't know, by bombing the things, it was cut off. They supposed to burn us. 40 miles from us, camps of boys were burned, men camps. Because I remember there were some young kids, they, like you said, they just knocked out a little piece from a, and they ran out and they hid themselves in the forest or something. And they came to us and they told us, and even the soldiers told us that they saw still burning people in 40 miles from us. So anyhow, the 3 days before that, they cut off all the electricity, the water, I don't know. And the same French workers who worked with us got around our camp. They put on already, they must have had their uniforms, and they didn't let them to destroy us. They were very, the French people were very nice. You can't compare them to the Poles, to the Germans. They were very brotherly, they were very comradeship. And they said, if you, the city hall had already a white flag, they for surrender, And they came there and they said, if you destroy those girls, remember, no one German won't be here. And somehow that's why we survived.
So they held the criminals in check. Is that what you... They stopped the criminals from... You said that common criminals had come into the camp.
They took us there. They took them there to us. As I told you, from city to city, if the English or the Russians were advancing, they took out the prisoners and took...
Were they in charge of you? Were they...
No. They were it's just funny to look at them. But no, they weren't in charge of us.
The men and women, or just women?
No, just women. Just women.
So the French soldiers were responsible, you think, for
our lives, yeah. The French soldiers and the French Jewish soldiers. I wish I can meet them maybe someday, but at that time you didn't think of take names or anything.
You were liberated by the Americans?
Yeah, but one tank, one boy was maybe 18 years old, a young boy. There were two people on the tank, and I remember we looked. At that time we were very close to the gate. Our windows, and you just could open the window and jump out of the window. It was like here. It was 36 years ago. We were livelier. And they said, look, they changed their clothes. They wore sport clothes, like hunting clothes, all the German big shots. They want to run away. That was 3 days before the war ended. They didn't want to go into as prisoners to the Americans, I don't know. So the last minute, they said, look, we thought the war ended, maybe they changed their lines or something. All the Germans are dressed in full uniforms. They gave themselves over as they were or something. And we saw the German, that Hauptstuttführer, that he was managing our camp. He was a big, tall man. And then looking out through the window, we saw they're raising up their hands. And we looked a little harder, we saw an American tank with a star. We didn't look for a door, for anything. We just jumped out of the window. There was a terrible... It was so good. It was so frightening. It's hard to express the feelings what we had.
Did you know what was happening when it happened? Did you realize?
Yes, because as I told you, yeah, we didn't have any water in the camp. So they were the Germans. All of those French soldiers were around us, and they were after the Germans not to hurt us, and they gave away their chocolates. They gave everything to them, so they wouldn't hurt us so badly. At that time, they used to go with us to get a little water from a river, and it was very close. It was maybe half a mile. So on the way, when we went for that little water, the French soldiers used to come to us and talk to us and told us that we're so close and this city is liberated and that city, and it's a matter of just time, hours, we will be liberated. We knew about it. And they even went to with the German to a German magazine, with that German who was over us, to a magazine where the soldiers had, they knew because they were there for so many years, 5-6 years, and it was a small city, a small town there. And they brought us dry potatoes that you could cook a little yourself and you could eat. It didn't taste good, but it was food. It was food. So we knew that any minute that we will be liberated. So two boys. And also, they would know about the camp there. The French soldier got with them on the tank and came to our camp, and they liberated us.
So the two American boys?
They were, yeah, I saw two American boys. And then later, maybe a half an hour later, the loudspeakers came to say to stay in the barracks. Doctors are coming. They'll... We're gonna have checkups. They took us to hospitals, checkups to see which is healthy, which is sick. The sick will go right away to the hospital. And they gave us food. We didn't get food. My husband got sick on typhoid because the soldiers were primitive. They gave them their own food to eat. And the people from concentration camp couldn't eat their food. They cooked for us rice and milk and raisins for me. 2 months, we couldn't eat it anymore later, but at least we didn't get sick.
Did they come out in German, the loudspeakers?
No. How did they speak? I think they spoke Polish. They, between the German, between the soldiers were Polish and German. And English too. They spoke English. I remember.
You were fluent in German. Did you learn that in school, in Lodz?
Well, who's speaking Jewish? You speak German.
They speak German because of Jews.
Yes, we did. We had it in school. I had only 1 year of German, but they did teach, because when I was ready for it, they didn't. They were boycotting the German language because of. They want their corridor. The government was against Germany because the population was so dumb and they were so primitive. If they could hurt a Jew, they didn't care how they hurt him.
All right, so you were liberated there. Do you remember the day?
Yeah, the 14th of April. And we always have the day off, the 14th of April. We go out to lunch, we have the day off. It was a beautiful day, the 14th of April, a sunny, beautiful day. Yeah, and the same French soldiers made a luncheon for us. Who could eat a beautiful luncheon with pastries, French pastry, yeah? But we couldn't. Right away, I think doctors came and they checked everybody for health reasons and checked our names, and we weren't dogs anymore, we were people.
What did you do immediately after that?
What did we do? We did go see the city, the town. I remember we saw the town.
Could you tell me about the stores that the Americans opened up?
The American soldiers knocked off, opened the doors from the stores.
In Germantown.
In Germantown, yeah. And gave us clothing and food, I don't remember. Clothing, shoes, coats, dresses, sweaters. I took for my sister and for my brother. I thought I'm going to meet him. I took for it. And the French, I think they were French Jews, they took us to there, wherever they had, and they made lunch for us, beautiful pastry and everything, and they took us to hospitals to be checked, and people right away took our names and where we were born and so our everything. We were people from that time on.
Were you in a displaced persons camp after that?
Yes. Well, there were frame barracks, you know, barracks with wires around. So we were there for a couple of days. They didn't have any place to put us. And maybe a couple of days later, they took us into Luftwaffe for pilots, where they train pilots.
Mm-hmm.
And the first time in my life I saw black men too, because they left and we came, so we had running hot water there, and we had a beautiful little room, my sister and I, and we had food. They gave us three times a day to eat food, also raisins and rice and milk, and it was, after a while you get a little tired of this, but that's what we ate. And doctors came, and we were under strict supervision of doctors.
You were there for 2 days?
Mm-hmm. 2 days we were in those frame barracks.
And then later, we
were from the middle of April, I think, until June we were there. And then it was, they changed territory. The territory they gave away to the Russians, and the Russians probably gave some territory to the United States. It was an exchange of territories, and we went to Braunschweig. I don't know if you heard, it was a city in Germany. Braunschweig was a big city, the streets were bombed, you couldn't walk through a street. And we were under the Pauls administration. We didn't like it there. They cooked us a cabbage, maybe three times a day, cabbage. So we were there for a couple of days. We didn't like it there. We didn't even know that Jewish men exist, Jewish boys. We thought that we were only the one survivors, like from a ship or something. And they took us to Bergen-Belsen. Who took us there? I think a rabbi came, and we were maybe 60 girls in that Polish camp. There were Polish officers.
This rabbi was a military rabbi? Was he a soldier or was?
Yeah, chapel. He came, I don't know how he found out, and it's all over the Braunschweig were camps, and I did see a camp that they used girls. I don't know if they were Jewish girls for prostitutes or they were Ukrainians or something, because some of the Jewish girls, like they took us 60 here and 60 there, they divided the camps.
After the war?
After the war. No, we saw the places. We didn't
I see.
We saw the place.
You were in a former concentration camp, a place that had been a concentration camp?
Yes. Well, it probably was a camp for the Ukrainians.
Mm-hmm.
For Russians, not for Jews. But we saw some girls were there, and we found out later when the rabbi came and told us there are some girls around here, I know, and he took all of the girls into Bergen-Belsen. Bergen-Belsen, we had Jewish people managing And we saw a Jewish man, and I met my husband there. But after the English left Bergen-Belsen, I think the Poles took over too. But the Jews didn't want to stay under the Poles, not in Germany. You know, everybody left, I guess.
Had you ever thought about going back to Lodz?
No, they asked us in the Salzwedel when they were exchanging territories. A Russian officer came, and he asked me if I want to go back. And they asked us, and we said, no, we have family in the United States, and I hope that the rest of the family will meet. Not in the United States, at that time we said America. It was South America. And I'm going to meet with my parents, with my brother there. We didn't want to go back. It was too hard to swallow to Poland again. I don't know who went back and who stayed there. Those people were sick in the head, believe me. It was nothing to look for in Poland.
When did you decide to come to the United States?
I decided. That was in 1949 already, 48, in the winter time.
Where were you living?
We were in Germany. I had already a child. And there were registering people to Canada. And at one point my husband was in Munich, and they said he saw registration to the United States. And he registered, and we went to, maybe 6 weeks later we got the affidavit we had to come to the United States. We wanted to go to Israel. My husband is a furrier, and he had some work to do, and he said, oh, I'm going to make a little more money so I can buy an ice box. At that time, people used to buy things to take to Israel, so we didn't expect any miracles, any luxury in Israel. So he worked a little more so we could buy things. So we got letters that it's very hard in Israel. Everybody came at once. There wasn't any rooms. It was terrible. It were hard conditions in Israel. And my husband didn't want to even hear. You saw him. He didn't want to even hear of coming to the United States. And I couldn't find my uncle from South America. And we were stuck, and we wanted to go to Israel. But the last minute, it took us 6 weeks to come to the United States. We didn't have a hard time, and thank God we were healthy. And my husband is not a black marketeer, so they didn't allow any sick people or somebody who had some. Anyhow, it took us 6 weeks to come to Detroit, and we came here straight to the Detroit.
Why Detroit?
That's what they picked, the Jewish Social Service.
Oh, the Social Service,
yeah,
right.
They send us here. I wish they would send us to New York. It would be better for my husband, for his trade.
But when did you get married?
Oh, in 1946, right after the war.
And where were you living then?
Well, we were in the mountains there. He didn't like Bergen-Belsen, so we went to... it was on the Austrian border, near Salzburg.
And you had known your husband before the war?
No, I didn't know him. I knew him from seeing, he used to be a neighbor there in the ghetto. I saw him maybe five times the first summer, 1940. And then he took off, and we didn't know, but he came to Bergen-Belsen to look at his sister and mother. We all had hopes that they are alive. Nobody would believe that what they did. no matter what you saw, you still think that your people will survive. You still had hope. And we got married, and I had a daughter. My daughter, I show you the picture of her. She's married now. She has two beautiful little boys, which we went to see them.
And she lives in Dallas, you say?
Yes, Fort Worth, yeah. Fort Worth, Dallas.
Did you feel that it was necessary for you to have children immediately? Did you think about it, or did it just happen?
I didn't want to have children. She was born 48, and we were liberated 45. But we saw everybody has a child, and they're so cute, and somehow you go with the everybody did it, so you did it too. Yes, I was afraid. I named them, my younger daughter, her name was Mary. I was afraid to give her a Jewish name.
Miriam?
Yeah, now she's Marla. And every time I had her, I used to have dreams, like you said, you're dreaming about it. I hid my kids in a Christmas tree. Don't ask, I have terrible dreams. Every time something happens, something even very good happens, it's deep in your mind and you dream about it. They wouldn't take away from you things.
You still dream about it?
Oh yeah, you still have nightmares.
When you came to the United States, did you talk to anybody about what had happened? Any neighbors, people you met?
Yeah, we came on 12th Street, all Jewish people. I knew a little English because I took English in school. We supposed to go to Israel, my parents. They were waiting for, what was the name of it? A certificate or something. They were waiting. They paid in money, we supposed to go. So at that time, the mandate was the English. So you learned Hebrew and you learned English. And I came here, I didn't say apple pie, I say apple cake, but I went into a bakery and I asked for those things. And so they corrected me. Oh, I didn't know what a hot dog is. I know a dog was a dog. I didn't know people were eating hot dogs, but you learn fast and you...
But did people ask you questions about it, or didn't they want to talk about it?
I don't even know at the time. There were all the elderly women there. Some of them I didn't like. They used to tell me, kiss the earth that you're here in the United States. They're, you know... I guess there wasn't a higher class on 12th Street at that time.
Did you meet any anti-Semitism?
Here in the United, no. I was working at Hudson's, and I found that they are much nicer, the American people, than... the American people are like the French people. They are nicer. I was a fitter at Hudson's. I know how to sew. And I had a German. The Germans are bad. And one German came to me and she said, how come all the Jews have Cadillacs? What can you tell her? I had to work. My husband had a business. I worked 3 days a week. I didn't answer her. She said that the Jews are like gypsies. They go from country to country. And one American guy told her, she was a Gentile, she told her, the Jews had to go because they were forced out from one country to another, because they believed in one God. She was, I guess, but the German was picking, and the Americans were on the side of the Jews. I guess they were more educated, they had a little feelings for the Jewish people.
Did you talk to your relatives about what happened to you? Ever? With your husband, your children?
Well, by the beginning, when they were little, we used to go here and there. I didn't want to talk to them about it because it was sad. And we were struggling for survival, financial. My husband was free a whole summer, was nothing to do. We were struggling, but then later when they grew up, and now my daughter, my son-in-law is an American, and she explained to him things. When she reads or she remembers what I used to tell, she understands better than him. She has more feelings.
So your children know?
Oh, yes, they do know, and they are very understanding and very smart. My older daughter, sometimes I tell her, I excuse myself, I'm sorry, I don't have the education as you have. So she's telling me, Mother, it's enough. The American people are the most educated people because we have the opportunity, the schools are free. And you had an interrupted life. So she understands me. I get along nicely with my kids. My younger one is a little different. She went to Ann Arbor. I don't know, Ann Arbor did it to her. But she's a very fine young lady. She's counseling people and she's good. She's very good, good natured, good.
They never
used any dope. I hope not, and not what I know.
Can I just ask you about one or two more questions about after the war? You started to tell me about the nightmares and things. Is there any time that certain situations that something comes through your mind?
Yes, as I told you, even happy ones. When I have a happy one or I'm buying myself something, I have dreams that the Germans are coming and they're taking away this from me.
Do you ever have any kind of memories of what you saw, what you went through, flash through your head?
In the daytime?
Mm-hmm.
I had here, I was frightened, I was petrified a couple of weeks ago, 2 weeks ago with the Germans there. I saw so many of them, I was real frightened. I didn't want to give up the seat, I would stay, I would take off my shoes, because she said it in German. And then later when I saw so many of them and I was thinking I'm going on a plane, if something would happen, they would know that I understood and I didn't want to move. Being a Jew, taking my papers, I have all the papers that I'm a Jew from the Hadassah, from the B'nai B'rith, in my wallet. I was a little frightened.
This is the experience on the airplane when somebody said not to sit down.
Yeah,
in German,
yeah. It wasn't on the airplane, it was in the waiting room. Yeah, on the airplane you have your own seat.
And you still have nightmares?
Yes.
Are they the same ones you had earlier?
Yes, I'm on the border, I'm looking at German, they're shooting, and we shouldn't go here, and we shouldn't go there, and just a couple of months ago I had some dream about camps. And something, when happens something to you in the daytime, you have the same things at night. And I'm avoiding, when I see a German, I avoid them. Some Jewish men marry German shiksas and they live with them. And when they have a fight with their husband, they tell them. They're selfish, they're arrogant, the Germans. And yeah, and the same thing, I'm sorry interrupting. I didn't care to sit down so much. It was the principle. We went on the... In Acapulco, they don't have that the airplane can be connected with the... You have to go on a little bus and they take you to the... There was a young Mexican couple, I don't know who they were, and I was standing and he offered me a seat. So here is a Mexican young man that offers me a seat, and he is a stupid German. He was talking so much about the seat. I would get up, but that, I don't know how to explain to you. It's something inside it. I was afraid to tell them because I knew that I'm going with them.
Was there any other incident on that trip?
No. Well, thank God I didn't see them in Mexico. I got them from the hotels, and the guide was very nice. I wouldn't believe they talk so open against their own government, against their dictator. I wouldn't believe it. I know that's a dictator in Mexico City, isn't it?
It's a democracy.
Is it democracy? Yeah. They tell you here on television there's a dictatorship there. And they took us to the city hall, to the palace, and to the church, to Catalonia. They want me to talk about this. The guide was explaining to us they have that wall murals. You heard of Diego Rivera?
Yeah.
I would like to go see it here because at that time it was cold and was already at the end of today. I was tired. And they're very open. They talk very openly against their government, against their. I thought if it's a dictatorship, you're afraid to talk, but they weren't.
It's a republic, I think.
Is it?
Your two daughters, have they ever been to Israel?
No, we couldn't afford it, really.
Have you ever been?
Yes, I was only once. I hope. I wanted to go to Israel very badly, but I'm waiting until my daughter will get married. Then I can go in peace, you know. My husband and I will go. We were struggling very much, so being a furrier, you don't know how many furriers closed up, and he finally closed up. We were struggling, and they used to go in the summer to school or work and to have. And my older one got married straight from school. And I hope they'll go, but the little boy goes in Jewish Sunday school. He's more of a Jew. Hopefully, that show you the pictures. Can I show you?
Sure, I'd like to see.
And he can be.
Did you, as long as you mentioned the belief in something, did you ever discuss with people before or during or after the war? Religious questions?
My husband sometimes does. How could we have God when a man, a big man, went in and killed a little child and nothing did happen to him? He asked them that. They don't have an answer for that. But still the life between Jewish people is much cleaner and nicer than with the Polacks. I couldn't be a Pole.
But you still, you belong to Shul, and you're still
here.
Yeah.
We belong to the survivors of Shire Supply. Yeah. And we have to. It's no other way. Somehow it's your way. They're nicer, they're cleaner, they're. Although the people are. Once they get too much money, they're as bad as the others. But.
You have hopes for your children and grandchildren?
I have hopes. I just have hopes for them that it will be nice and bad.
You're very proud of them, I can see.
Yes, I'm proud of them. I'm a little overprotected, but they have to take it for the territory. I'm telling this my younger daughter that she complains that I'm overprotected.
Well, there could be worse things, I guess.
And to be overprotected.
Thank you very much for the time.
Yeah, you're welcome. If I